Welcome to Write On, the podcast from Final Draft. This is the show where we talk about screenwriting, filmmaking, and everything in between. I'm your host, Phil Galasso, and today we have a special guest co-host, Sade Sellers.
Hi, Phil.
Hello. So we had the opportunity to talk with Josh Ruben, the writer, director, and star and producer and probably craft service guy of the new film, Scare Me. I had a blast with this film. What about you, Sade?
I loved this film so much. It has so much heart and depth and warmth, but also it is a little scary, a little campy. It's definitely something, while watching it, makes me think of what me and my friends used to do, like when we had sleepovers and telling scary stories. So it's like like mashed potatoes for me. It's very comforting.
I know what you mean. It reminded me, and this is not to say quality-wise it's anywhere near. I did a student film when I was at NYU that was about three film students sitting together, each telling a story, and then the stories played out. So I think it's something that anybody who's, you know, had an interest in writing or filmmaking has probably done something along these lines, though not as good. Not as good.
Well, I mean, Josh is just super smart. Like, you'll hear in the interview, he's so aware of production from top to bottom, which is always my motto. Like, you can't just be a writer. You have to understand how the world works that you're creating. So you can definitely tell that he's done every job in this industry. And that's why he did do every job on this movie.
For sure. And, you know, and we get into this a bit in the interview, you know, it's a relatively low budget movie, and the way he uses the budget is really smart, really economical. And it really just brings the performances by him and Aya Cash and Chris Redd to the forefront and really makes the whole thing pop.
Yeah, it's an actor's dream, this film, honestly, an actor's dream.
Well, with that said, let's roll the tape. Enjoy, everyone. Well, Josh Ruben, thank you for taking the time to chat.
Thanks for having me.
Yeah. So, Scare Me. For those of our listeners who may not have watched the movie or heard about it yet, can you summarize it in a nutshell?
Sure. Two strangers stay up all night writing out a power outage, telling each other scary stories. Those scary stories manifest in the dark of a Catskills cabin, but the scariest tale of all is Fanny is a better storyteller than Fred.
So, I mean, this film, which is really, it was a lot of fun, and it's about the nature of storytelling in a lot of ways. And I'm curious how you approach that, both, you know, as a writer yourself and then as a performer. You know, what were you looking to express when making this film?
That's a really good question. I sort of terraformed an indie to my resources in a Duplassian kind of way. I was sick of directing commercials and wanted to make something. And so, you know, the drive was to make the kind of film that I'd want to pop on and escape as a kid, you know, like Stephen King's Cat's Eye or, you know, Jaws, you know, to go a little more quality, quote unquote. And what I ended up doing was writing angry. You know, the beginning of 2018 was the height of the Me Too movement. Aziz Ansari, by the time that I had popped up my first draft, was outed for taking advantage of a woman who'd written that article, which, you know, has since, I guess, the accusations have been more or less controversial. But the point is, you know, I'd been having a lot of impassioned conversations with women about gender dynamics and about their sort of being taken advantage of, more women than I realized in my close circle, friends and fans of mine, via my college humor days, which is a very male-oriented site, which I found kind of ironic. So I'm not sure if this answers your question, but, you know, what started is my just kind of wanting to cross off the bucket list item of making a film. And I made a pact, like, I'm going to do this no matter what, even if it means I'm holding the boom and acting at the same time, became this sort of a, you know, midnight movie, an anthology film that never leaves the campfire, with this kind of edgier DNA to it, I guess, social DNA.
You mentioned the, you know, wanting to attack the gender dynamics and, you know, talking about toxic masculinity and all that stuff that's, you know, we've been really been at the forefront of the cultural conversation over the last few years in a way that it hadn't been previously. This is also a funny movie. It's also a horror movie. You know, horror comedies by their nature are you know, that's a tricky balance to do already. And then you're throwing in these, you know, real heavy themes. Talk about just, you know, your approach to that, you know, how much is too much, does it have to pass the smell test? How did you manage to balance all those different things?
That's a great question. I mean, I knew I didn't want to make a ham-fisted Me Too movie by any means, but I did want to go after a very kind of specific, nuanced, icky truth, which is some men, especially white 30-something privileged males, can't self-soothe in the face of a woman's success. And they don't quite know how to deal in the face of a woman's greatness, especially when they feel entitled to that position or place. Fred feels entitled to the position or place that Fanny's in. You're my age. In fact, I'm a little older than you. I should be doing what you're doing. What you're doing isn't that great. You're here. So he calls out and tries to make his way through the crevice of, whatever crevice that exists or he perceives exists. So I know that doesn't fully answer your question, but I knew that if we, you know, ultimately I'm a funny human being. I is funny. Chris Redd and Becky Drysdale are very funny. This was going to be a funny movie. We were going to play the humor, but you know, we weren't going to go in at 11. We were going to play everything quite realistically. And you can justify certain behaviors once you introduce, you know, Coke and alcohol into the equation and everything else. But
I really love, Josh, about the character of Fred, too, is that he has this nice guy portrayal, right? Because when we think about toxic masculinity, we always think about, oh, it's just this macho dude in tight t-shirts. And obviously, he's very like, man, man, man. But Fred's, I've met so many Freds in my lifetime. Like, oh, he's funny. He's chill. He's cool. But there's those little tings of like, ooh, he's really insecure. And just me existing is making him insecure. I think my favorite line, because I wrote it down actually, was when Fanny says, I'm a woman female writer in horror. Everyone steals from me. You know how I deal with it? I'm just better. And I'm just like, oh, that got me in my heart right there. I was like, oh my gosh, I retweeted that. And I just think that just encompasses everything about being a woman in a nutshell. So when I saw that you wrote it and directed it, I was like, how does he know all of this? You said you talked to a lot of women and heard these stories.
I talked to a lot of women and heard these stories. I'm also a 5'7" and change, formerly chubby kid who didn't have very many friends, has a lioness mother, a half sister who's a singer songwriter, who's one of my heroes. I had three great aunts and two aunts on my mom's side, one on my dad's side, all of which are characters, all of which are strong women, all of which, you know, march to the beat of their own drum. And most of the guys in my life were shitty. I know a lot of shitty men, you know, like a lot of guys are shitty. And a lot of the women and, you know, a lot of my friends are women. You know, this is like the ever contentious conversation I've had with every girlfriend I've ever had is, you know, you have a lot of women friends. That wasn't to get close to all of them to try and sleep with them. They're all better listeners. They all, 90% of the time don't have some other motivation, don't feel competitive, raise me up, you know? And so as you realize, as you get older, you know, we're talking a lot about protests these days, you know, your friendships are protests, your friendships are activism to a degree. And so I've done a lot of work to kind of cleanse my life of the people that don't serve me and raise me up. And a good deal of them are Freds. A good deal of them go out of their way and you can sort of hear them needle. And it's intergender-ish, you know, the dynamic is exists within, you know, the same genders. I know it exists between two women. You hear about cattiness and you can, it's a fascinating thing to examine when women do it to each other. With men, it's, you know, we're all quite familiar with it. So I was really excited to not go after the kind of easy target of like the shitty macho troll or the jock, but the ones who are a little more gray area.
Something about this film, I'm just curious, you know, on the page versus the final film, you have these, you know, people, it's basically a film of people just telling stories to each other. How do you convey some of that on the page, you know, versus what someone like Aya or Chris Redd brings to it, the you know, just the sheer performance of it? How do you put that on the page in a way that an actor can read it and then make it their own?
Well, you know, one of the things I love, and I've come a long way as a writer, and I've learned quite a bit as a writer, but I love minimalist dialogue, almost like Mamet-ian kind of back and forth. Like when you can read a script and it's almost all dialogue with minimal description, which is not how I started at all. I would describe, you know, the comedic joke of the magazine cover in a corner by the bookshelf with the thing on it, which you don't do. That's for your production designer to, I've learned all these things, but I wanted to kind of, you know, that scare me was kind of an exercise, at least in the sparring, in minimalist back and forth dialogue. So I wanted to keep the description as minimalist as possible. And when things sort of pick up, you know, werewolf hands and shadows and gnarled trees and the like, I have to relook at it now and see how it showed up on the page. But I tried to keep everything as minimalist as possible so that my actors could take it and ultimately go like, oh, okay, well, maybe I'll interpret it this way. It's been really interesting to hear, you know, especially Aya too, you know, who played Fanny, you know, described as a narcissist who's getting a kick out of Fred putting on this show. And then it ends up being a little bit too much. You know, she's pushed it too far and ends up in a situation a lot of women find themselves in at the end of the night with a strange dude they don't know quite well, when alcohol's involved and, you know, everything else. So, I think that there's the short answer longer is minimalism. It's, you know, and by nature of that minimalist description, keeping the script as tight as possible, you're in essence giving a lot up to the actors. But I did that as a director too. I said, you know, I'm not a stickler for the ums and uhs. You can do whatever you want, like make this your own. And they did.
One thing Sade and I were talking about before this, when we were just talking about the film, was the sound and how integral the sound is to the experience of watching the film. And just talk about how you use sound, because it feels like you were able to make up the production value exponentially just with the incredible sound design. And I'm curious about, like, you know, how much you thought about that while you were writing the script and then directing it and then in post.
Well, part of the angle to pitching Scare Me and getting it done was that this is going to be a sound designer's movie, a composer's movie. One thing I fantasized about was the first credit title, once we hit to credits at the end, was sound design by, but I don't think the union allowed that or some kind of weirdness. But I love that. That was part of the pitch. I'd never seen something like this before where, you know, we're essentially doing story theater, you know, Paul Sills, Viola Spolin story theater, where, you know, we're leaving it truly up to the viewer to see a good deal of it. And then when the writers are in flow, when creative is in flow, it sort of manifests that, you know, became the kind of rule backbone of the movie. So I knew that that was going to be part of the angle, that it was a campfire film that never left the campfire, and that we'd sort of, you know, bring it all to us. And that, you know, that was just how we executed on this very low budget was, you know, it also, it satisfies the low budget sense of it, is that we can't see the werewolves. We can't see all these creatures. We can kind of feel them around us. And a lot of it was trusting the performances. A lot of the criticism, or a lot of the praise we've been getting, is this wouldn't be the same movie without the cast. You needed a cast that would fully commit to all this, you know, ridiculous stuff. So the sound design element, you know, I mean, everything I love about, you know, Insidious and Killing of a Sacred Deer, the films of Yorgos Lanthimos, even though, you know, this film was made well before Host was Rob Savage's Host, but, you know, the simplicity of looking in a darkened corridor where there's nothing. Lee Winnell did this brilliant. This is all Invisible Man. As I just rewatched Invisible Man again last night, an empty corridor with a sheet over a statue and just sound, or the sound of a creek, is so effective. You don't need all the cutty green grass kind of, you know, Marvel shit to make you feel more, or maybe then you know, whatever feel in Ant-Man 3. So not to compare Scare Me to Ant-Man 3. But
no, you can, totally.
But I can. I'm Paul Rudd. I wish. God, he looks great. Going into it, the key with the sound, you know, with Ian Steinus and John Morris, who are our mixer and our sound designer, was let's not get caught bringing these sounds out. I never want the sounds to distract. They should always sound quite real world. You know, there were some gory sounds that have John, you know, always pull back on, or, you know, creaks that would be too loud, or the dog keeling over in the corner when they don't exist. It was like too big, too whiny, and almost was like too much to hear a dog die or meow, as opposed to just boom, you know, getting that specific. And as a comedian, sound is everything. So that was where I was really, really nitpicky with those guys. And the key was groundedness. The key was, again, not being distracting, and they knocked it out of the park.
And then Josh, how does that look on the page? Because a lot of younger writers will get the advice, like, no onomatopoeias. Onomatopoeias, right? Yeah. Mm-hmm. Like, don't add your sound design into your scripts, but you knew you were going to direct it. So how does that reflect on the page?
God, who's the writer who did, Tom Fontana. I was randomly 100 years ago was going to do a job for Tom Fontana when like people were starting to dip their feet into like webisode territory. And I remember reading some of his scripts and he wrote capital letters here, H-E-A-R colon. So that's kind of been my device for describing sound. So I never see here, you know, crack, you know, A's up and down, uppercase and lowercase A's. But I'll say here, you know, the delicate footsteps, you know, the toes on the linoleum floor, you know, crackling down the stairs or whatever.
Oh, I love that. I love that advice.
Yeah, it's just pretty straightforward. It's, you know, and again, trying to keep that description to one line or two lines, just because also it's just prettier. It's just like when you're giving it to someone for the first time and you know it's going to stop at 90 pages, there's something about devouring that just helps, you know, helps it. When you see long paragraphs, your brain just kind of, your eyes kind of cross, you know. So on the page, it was often here colon blank, you know, we hear colon the sounds of, and that's its own line.
With something like this, where it is so contained and there's so few characters and the storytelling is very precise. I'm curious, what was the writing process for you like on this? Was it mostly there in the first draft? Did it take you a while to refine the different stories? How much did it change once you had your cast, you know, and they were making it their own? What was the process like there?
That's a great question. I wrote it very, very quickly. The first draft, I think I popped out in 3 days. I had a lot going. There was a lot going on. There was the stuff in the world. So, you know, January 2018 had happened. Aziz had happened. Kevin Spacey had happened. Weinstein had happened. So was that stuff going on in the world? I directed a crafting competition commercial with Busy Phillips and was so nervous and didn't feel in any way creatively inspired, even though she was lovely. And was desperate to make a movie and wanted to make something that theoretically I could fund myself or I could go 50-50 on with my producing partner and my DP, Brendan Banks. So I knew that I wanted to make something kind of fast and furious, like, you know what, I'm just going to make the thing to get it done. And part of that inspiration came from Like Brothers. The Duplass's book is phenomenal if you haven't read it. And I recommend it to a lot of filmmakers, young filmmakers, and anyone who wants the short version of it can watch the Cavalry Isn't Coming speech that he gave at South by Mark Duplass, that you just got to pick the thing up and make the thing. And so the process was, I'm just going to see if I can get away with, these two characters in a cabin. There originally was no Carlo. Thank God there is. And I was just kind of, you know, writing this dynamic between the two. And then the stories were sort of an amalgamation of old cobweb collecting ideas I'd had in drawers, you know, a scary story I would tell, you know, friends as a kid, you know, this ghost dog, I heard footsteps upstairs and then saw a dog, you know, descend the stairs and walk out the back door. I swear to God, I saw it. No, I didn't. Just wanted to sound cool. Cause I never had a paranormal experience. So I guess I defaulted to a dead dog walk down my stairs. It's not even a beginning, middle or end really. And then ultimately with the confluence, what was going on in the world, it's like, okay, scary stories. And then maybe in the end, we'll flip the switch and the guy's been a serial killer the whole time. The guy's been a psycho the whole time. So I was trying to justify, you know, forging myself an actor's showcase as a comedian and then seeing I also love the idea of playing in that sort of territory while also sparring with an actress who isn't in a sexualized role, sparring with an actress who gets to do all kinds of shit we've never seen her do from, you know, whatever, an impression of an old man to, you know, animal sounds to whatever.
And so anyway, she's so good at it. She's phenomenal. So good at it.
Aya is so funny. She's like, you know, when I said I wanted an acting challenge, I meant like a period piece, not, you know, bark like a dog and do a Crypt Keeper impression. but anyway, so that confluence of stuff was truly getting on the page and like writing what I knew. I wanted to write minimalist. I wanted to write for an actress where, you know, no one's wearing a bikini and there's no romantic spark. It's all competition. And ultimately, I wanted to make it feel like the types of movies that I'd want to just pop on as a kid and watch and kind of, you know, and eat pizza. And from a business perspective, genre, and I'm a horror lover, so it was always going to be some kind of genre anyway, is the way to go. Theoretically, we'll make our money back someday. So that was the confluence, and that was why the barf happened so fast. And the movie got made quickly, I think, because of, again, the social relevance of it, you know. I sort of lied and said this thing's only going to cost, you know, this much change. And now we're here.
And speaking of Aya real quick, how did you find her? Because now she's on The Boys and I know her as Stormfront, which what a great find. But like, how did you connect with her? She is sensational. Like, you both play with each other very, very well in this film.
Thank you. I'm so grateful she trusted me. I was just writing out answers to another journalist before we hopped on. And, you know, I was just kind of realizing what we'd known each other through her husband, Josh, whose name is also Josh. We shared a voiceover agent back in the day. But I think through Josh or otherwise social media, just knew that I was like doing the thing and knew that I wasn't a first timer. And so there was this kind of convenience to the fact that she'd finished You're the Worst, which I was aware of, but hadn't quite devoured until she was interested in the movie. And then I did, and it was like, holy mackerel. Because I think my first real realization of who she was, because she's such a chameleon, is Wolf of Wall Street. People don't realize she was Leonardo DiCaprio's right hand who screams and attacks him.
I did not put that together. You just blew my mind. You're right. She was.
She disappears. She disappears in that part. You wouldn't quite know it was her. And she's holding her own with, you know, Reiner and DiCaprio and, you know, Jonah Hill and you name it. And she also is a local to the town we shot in. We shot in my hometown. We shot in the Hudson Valley. She lives nearby. So not only was she, you know, the quote unquote easy ask, not only was she looking to, you know, she loves to work. She finished this show. She wanted to spend some time at home. So I took advantage of that and said, hey, you're home. Would you want to do this thing? And she trusted me. She read it and was down and down to play. And because she comes from theater, it works so well. You know, because Chris Redd is in the live performance world, it works so well, and we work well together. And they're collaborative. You know, they're not jerks. These are like wonderful collaborative people that like take big bold choices, and that's why it was so great.
Who do you think had the best Crypt Keeper impression?
Well, I would tell you it's me because she copied me to do the impression. But I think by nature of the fact that she'd never done it before, I think she should get all the points.
Her laugh was pretty good.
It's pretty good. I love the pushing her skeletal mandible back in her skull. It was very funny.
You mentioned that, you know, the Carlo character wasn't initially in your, you know, your first thought of it. At what point and why did you decide to bring that character in?
Ray Winsome, who is one of the producers early in on Get Out, he works for a company called QC, did not invest in this movie, but we got close. We had a talk, a really nice talk, and he gave me a couple of suggestions, the first of which was make it a little more gray area that this Fred guy doesn't just light switch become psycho in the end. That's not quite real. And that was, I was so resistant to it because I just like, you know, the punchiness of, yeah, but now it becomes a real horror movie and she'll, you know, protect herself. And originally she like killed Fred and rolled him up in a carpet and left him in, you know, his car, or, you know, put him somewhere. I don't know, as Bettina like came up to grab him. It was some kind of moment like that. And I'm so glad he suggested it. Oh gosh, I just lost my train of thought for the, why did I say that about the ending?
We were talking about why you introduced the character.
Oh yeah, well that was another thing. Sorry. So yeah, he suggested along with that switch to the end. I don't know if you're going to want to do this movie with just two people. And I'm so glad he suggested bringing in Carla, because, you know, some of our criticism is not only is it fat, but he puts it over the hill, and he really, really is. He really, really does. So I just listened to that and I just thought, okay, well, how fun would it be for, you know, Venus to be a two-hander? And then you have this kind of third wheel dynamic. And that truly justifies the compounded situation we find ourselves in. Fred pushes himself to, or is pushed to, by the end of Act Three, his jealousy, and talk about being unable to self-soothe in those situations. You know, watching your competitor with another man who has total insulation against your insecurities, has no insecurities, and can just jump in. So I'm thrilled that I wasn't resistant to that one ultimately.
And with the sort of unsung hero of the movie in a lot of ways is the Bettina character. And I'm just curious, two things. One, was it in the script to pronounce James Cameron, or was that her the way she pronounces James Cameron cracked me up every single time.
Me too.
I'm pretty sure I get credit for that one. She said she came up with Eliza Minnelli. for sure, and then checking her teeth. I mean, Drysdale works for Key and Peele, and is a brilliant writer. I'd say writer first, maybe alongside, you know, improv performer. So she's formidable and had plenty of zingers, and I'm so grateful. She was a very last minute casting drop. And that was the cameo. I was like, oh, that'll be, you know, Kathy Bates, Stephen King universe casting, you know, and like where we landed with Becky was phenomenal. And I'm so thrilled she did it.
And Bettina's my favorite character, by the way. My favorite. Not only because I love the name Bettina and no one ever uses it, I'm like, perfect name. But I'm from Michigan. I'm from a small town in Michigan. And when I go home, I'm like the big town hero because I'm from the big city. And that's exactly how they treat you when you get in the car. Like, oh, do you know James Cameron? Like, have you heard Beyonce?
Honestly, that's the thing, is that it's in part based on a car ride I had from, I think, Newark Airport to Woodstock once, where the guy, you know, was not only pitching me on his script ideas, which I think was about Cora, which I didn't know anything about. I'm almost, so that's a rip from real life, right? What you know. And I think he mentioned it being something that, you know, if James Cameron saw it. But then he started to talk about his like personal life. I just thought, how fascinating, you know, these folks that latch onto the big city.
So comfortable. Yeah.
So comfortable. So comfortable. Just like in LA, you know, you get in one, they just, you know, they want to give you your headshot, even if you're, you know,
I just had to move to Los Angeles. And then all of a sudden everybody in New York that I knew in Long Island had a cousin or a friend or a dentist who had a script they wanted to send me because, I'm in LA. I must be able to get it done. It's like,
no, the guys, my mom still pitches me to this day. My mom still pitches me.
dad here. Yeah. God bless him.
So just kind of taking a big step back, what's your writing process like in general? Are you someone who wakes up early and cranks out pages? Do you set deadlines for yourself? Are you a big outliner? How do you go about it?
It's changed through the years. I would typically write just kind of start, and I'd hit a wall around 33 pages. I have 3 or 4 screenplays that stop at 33 or 35 pages because I didn't know where I was going. So I'm kind of writing cool, you know, and then hitting that wall. When I've outlined with partners. I've only outlined with partners 2 or 3 times. And that's typically when we write, you know, in no time, you know, it just becomes kind of, color by numbers. And these days, you know, I'm kind of, it's a combination. Now that I know you have to have multiple kind of textures to it, I took such a back door to writing and learning how to write. I can't really read, you know, like McKee, but I read On Writing, you know, Stephen King's On Writing is so invaluable. And, William Goldman's book, I made about halfway through.
You didn't read Save the Cat?
Save the Cat I don't remember if I picked it up. I might own it, but I remember at some point I bought like the screenwriter's Bible. I bought all these books, but I was getting a lot more out of Writing Down the Bones by Emily. I can't remember her last name. It's a brilliant book by Stephen King's on writing and by reading screenplays. And then in talking to writer buddies, one of my most, I think, mind-blowing experiences was Deidre Mangan, who is a television writer, who's a friend of mine, who said, you know, movies are essentially like, they're like 8 15-minute short films. And that was what really kind of blew my mind. I think congruently, was it Craig Mazin or John August who said, you know, act two is really where you should be having the most fun. That's where I always get caught up. But it's like when you
put
the protagonist up in the tree and throw rocks at him.
You listen to script notes, I see.
Yes, I think that was, and there was one specifically where he mentioned that that sort of metaphor. So it's kind of all over the place. I think now I'm just a little more thoughtful and just a more aware of the aforementioned. And my rule going forward is to make sure truly that I'm saying something so that, you know, I have an engine. Scare Me happened so fast because of what it was, what the social heart of it was. So I'm going to try really hard not to write cool, as I call it. And that, ultimately I'm really, really saying something and that I feel passionate about that thing because, you know, you're talking 2 years of your life. You know, this was 2 years ago that Emma wrote me. Yeah. Writing Down the Bones by Natalie Goldberg. Thank you. Not Emily, Natalie Goldberg. That's a great book.
Shout out to Natalie Goldberg.
Yeah. Natalie Goldberg. It's awesome.
So you mentioned sort of taking a backdoor into this. Let's jump to the start of your career. Take us from, you know, when you first had the instinct to become, you know, a storyteller. You worked on, you know, you mentioned College Humor. Take us from the beginning to where you are now. You know, what were the practical steps you took to get here?
Well, I started as an actor and no one was going to spoon feed me a great role or a great gig. And so I started making videos with my friends back in 2001, 2002. My parents bought me, it was a tape recorder, like a camcorder right before I moved to New York City just after 9/11. And I started making videos with my old summer camp friend, Sam Reich, who now owns College Humor. And Sam and I sort of decided to start a sketch group. We would have our buddies make videos and put those videos online. And this is before Flash and before YouTube.
Like right before YouTube, right? And like
correct.
A year before YouTube.
Correct. Yeah. And, you know, right when like Homestar Runner was a thing and Whitest Kids You Know and Derek Comedy and Invisible Engine, we were a part of that movement. And so College Humor took a liking to us because we were making stuff with our friends. They said, we want you to do for us what you've been doing for yourselves. So my backdoor, my side door thing was, as an actor, can't get a gig as an actor, I'm going to make my own shit. And that coming to the back door is literally figuring out how to produce from scratch. Well, if, you know, we need extras, we'll go on Craigslist and offer sandwiches and, you know, $20 or whatever. And kind of working my way backwards and getting my ass kicked tons of times along the way, learning, you know, you don't do 15 takes if you don't need it, and about safety and about, you know, comfort and, you know, keeping your crew, you know, fed and caffeinated and, you know, all the basic stuff. So anyway, at College Humor, once I was asked to come aboard full time by Sam, who was brought on full time before us to sort of start the originals department, I went to film school. You know, I was just essentially a high school graduate who went to an acting program after the fact. College Humor, I just got thrust into my film experience, was making videos with my friends on an HVX. And here I am making hundreds, if not when I left 7 years later, thousands of things, from animation to music video parody to horror parody to commercial parody. You know, my friend Dan Schechter, who's done a few independent films, told me once, he came to visit the office, he said, you have more experience than I do working on set, being a College Humor, than I do as a film director. And I was like, no, I don't. He said, no, I've done a movie and you've directed hundreds more at the time, you know, 50s more sketches. You've been on set that many more times. I'm like, shit. So in retrospect, those tools really, you know, amassed the tool belt that I had to kind of make everything, you know, to make it this far.
And what was the film school?
The acting school was the New Actors Workshop. It was founded by Mike Nichols and Paul Sills and George Morrison. So Mike Nichols was one of my acting instructors. He'd come in once a week and do a scene study class. I only ever had the courage to get one scene up in front of him. But as a first year student, you got to just observe this 3-hour class. And as a second year student, you got to put scenes up in front of him. The class, it doesn't exist anymore. This is back when people could afford to take 2 years to, you know, do acting school and work part time in New York City forever ago. But College Humor was my film school. I didn't really go. I kind of learned through the back door. College Humor turned into, as we started doing branded video, I started directing commercials. And so my career started to take this kind of divergence. I started directing commercials and chasing the money, so to speak. And I got, you know, really sick of it, you know? It's a great career, but it led me to scare me. And every begrudging step I took along the way, like, oh, you know, I'm doing a crafts commercial. Every one of them, every time I've been on set as an actor or a director, has taught me how to do it better and how to make movies, how to make stuff better.
So you were TikToking before there was TikToking.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah,
I was vining, basically.
You're vining. That's right.
How much does your experience as an actor feed into your writing? Does it help you in terms of creating characters that actors will want to play? What is the relationship between those two facets of yourself?
I think from the writing approach, I think more in terms of the types of movies I want to watch, and then hopefully that inadvertently affects the character and character choices, and you know what actors ultimately hopefully will be attracted to. I'm sure there's some spiritual congruency to the characters that I write and my wanting to, you know, make them fun, but it's like love of movies and love of what I want to see first.
Mm-hmm. Wait, Josh, I really have to ask this, because when Ben Affleck said he was going to direct and star in Batman, I gave him a lot of crap. I was like, you have to pick one, sir. And you are writing, directing, and acting. So like, what's the secret? Did you have a kick-ass first AD? Are you just crazy? Like, how do you do all of that?
I'm definitely crazy. I'll tell you, I understand Batfleck for not doing it, or how it didn't ultimately happen, because that's a 500 person operation. Scare Me was a 30 person operation with a 4-person cast, and I'm one of those cast members. It's far more manageable to self-direct and to direct when you're in one house with one crew with, you know, whatever minimal moves. I work really well under pressure. When people have asked me to do live shows as a performer, I typically don't prepare and just sort of decide at the last minute. I'm writing the last minute and usually do pretty well. It's not a good quality to have. That has its, its side effects for sure. I love multitasking, and, I've got a Gemini rising situation going on. So I need to satisfy that part of my, I guess, information and communication brain.
Gemini rising. So you are crazy.
Yeah, yeah. I think I'm Scorpio rising, but Gemini Mercury. So it's a communication. You know what I mean? We can have another podcast about that. Believe me, I know. I'm from Woodstock, New York, so I know my astrological shit. I deferred quite a bit to Brendan. Brendan, my cinematographer, we had a relationship as filmmakers and collaborators leading up to Scare Me, where I would write the thing, or write and be in the thing, and he would shoot it and direct it. Or I would direct a commercial that he would shoot just as a shooter. We kind of tried a rotation of collaboration combinations, and knew that we could trust each other. And that's what brought me to essentially saying, hey, you know, I want to do this thing. And we had a code on set. You know, we storyboarded, we certainly shot listed, you know, this movie to a T, but I knew every corner of this house and what every corner of the house represented as far as shots, as far as stories, you know. So by the fireplace, this was going to represent, you know, the grandpa, and then Troll was going to be all about the couch and all about looking up at the ceiling. You know, the act three was going to get into a brand new place we haven't seen before in the house, you know, the bedroom. And so I deferred a good deal to him so that by the point we got on set, I said, we are not going to argue about anything if we don't need to. There'll be no discussion, no disagreement about anything on this tiny, tiny set. We'll already have talked about all this stuff and gotten that all out of the way. So by the time I get to the shoot, we talk about what's going on. We, you know, we do the rundown of the day. I go downstairs, I get in makeup, and I can just be there for Aya or be there for Chris as an actor. Cause that's the other thing you got to do is show up as an actor. You can't put that stuff, you know, to the cat that can't necessarily be third place. Everything needs to be, you know, needs to be in equal standing. So that piece of it was Brendan. Typically I never had to look at the monitor. He would take a picture of the monitor and show me on his iPhone what the frame looked like. And I'd say, move it over just a little bit, make it a little less symmetrical or more so. And that's how we did it the whole step of the way. And his code for me not, you know, like me doing a stinky take was, you sure you don't want another one?
I use that line. And you know, actors are always like, don't give me notes as an actor, but I'm sure you're like, hey, not actor note, I'm directing note. Can you say this line this way?
Yeah.
You know, right now we're in the middle of a crazy situation in the world. How are you managing to stay sane if you are and creative and productive? Do you have any tips you can share?
Well, I'm in the very fortunate position to have just come out of a 5-month editing fog, working on my second feature film, which is in the can. It's called Werewolves Within. It's from Ubisoft, a great script written by Mishna Wolf with Sam Richardson starring. And so I kind of came out of that fog because my poor fiance was like living life, sort of looking around like the world's falling apart when I'd be in front of the computer editing like over Evercast. Now that sort of rolled into Scare Me Press, which has been so phenomenally serendipitous for my brain and just great to communicate with new people and talk about the movie and sort of, you know, escape from what's going on. But you know, there's not a whole lot of need for me to escape. I'm catching up on books that I've, you know, had kind of by the bedside table. And I'm talking to different authors whose work that I'd love to adapt, you know, in the horror kind of space and thinking about, you know, different stuff that I want to work on just as a writer. I think I'm probably piling on too much, even with nothing going on. you know, that's how I guess I'd like to work.
Is there, you know, so your career has taken, you know, a few different permutations from the college humor stuff to commercials to now making a feature. Is there a lesson you've learned along the way that you'd like to go back and tell that guy who's just starting out in 2001?
Oh yeah. There's three that are all tied. The first is there's always going to be a better idea. So even if you think that this one is the golden of goldens, there will be 10 more in its place. So don't sweat the small stuff, regardless of what happens with that one or if someone, you know, got ahead of you. The second one is your friends are your activism. So when you get that icky feeling about who you're close to and you don't have a good feeling about who's close to you and about who's working with you, only keep the ones around who raise you up and who want to raise you up and you want to raise up. It's just like a marriage or a partnership. You know, it took me a long time to realize that I was surrounded by some folks that did not want to see me succeed. And it's hard to confront that cleansing process, especially as you get older, it typically becomes easier, you know, like our parents, like we don't have friends. Why do we need friends? you keep the golden ones close to you and you'll know them and your life will legit change. And that's the core of getting out there and making your own thing is starting with friends, starting with a network and starting with people who like are honest with you, will give you honest feedback, but not do it to needle, to not be a fret about it, not make you feel like shit about it. When you walk away hanging out with your friend, you're like, why do I feel like shit? Well, they probably need to confront if that person's a friend. So, you know, again, like not sweating the small stuff. Your friendship is activism, keeping the ones close to you that serve you and that you want to serve them. And then the third thing is constantly make shit and make shit with those friends. Pick up the iPhone, you know, and mess around, edit stuff on iMovie, you know, make a narrative podcast with those buddies and make as much stuff as you know, as possible and help them out. And that's how you like build your network. And that's
the those key. Are great advice. You should do like a advice podcast. I like that.
Yeah, that's good writing advice and good life advice.
Yeah, it's important. You don't hear a lot about the friends thing, but it's true. People, you know, you just see a lot of our favorite people working with the same people, and that's what that is. Even if they're like toxic folks, the toxic folks have their own click where they serve each other, you know what I mean? So you're always gonna that's a constant. That will always be a constant.
Well, other than Scare Me, which everybody should check out on Shudder, it's October, it's spooky movie time. You got a spooky movie recommendation?
Oh my goodness, so many. I love Relic. Natalie Erica James is so good. That one really, really surprised me.
Bella Heathcote is amazing in that.
Yeah, unbelievable. I highly recommend Relic. And I have a friend, my buddy Charlie McQuaid, who's one of my golden ones who I keep around and keeps around me somehow. He saw Fright Night last night for the first time, the original.
Oh, wow.
The original? Oh, nice.
I was so jealous that you're seeing it for the first time.
Hey, that remake's not bad either. That remake is not bad.
I would check that out. Oh, it's Colin Firth.
Colin Firth.
Colin Farrell.
Oh, yeah. Colin Farrell.
And, rest in peace, the other actor who died. He passed away. I feel bad.
Anton.
Yeah, Anton. Yeah.
Oh, my God, that's Anton. Right. He did it. Oh, I'd check it out just for Anton. I think, I think Relic and Fright Night and Let the Right One In, those are like my...
Yes. Tops, no, that remake's not so great.
Yeah.
Oh, I thought that remake was good. I like the remake.
That was Reeves, right? Was it Matt Reeves?
Yeah, Matt Reeves. Yeah. I like that one. No, it's not as good as the original, but I like it.
Nothing's as good as the original. That's bonkers.
Friday, what about you? You got a scary movie recommendation?
Oh my gosh, you guys know this is my season and my powers have been restored, spooky season. I still like The Ritual. I love The Ritual. If you guys haven't seen it, it's on Netflix currently. A group of friends go on a friend trip and things happen. I like The Ritual. I really love that movie.
So good.
Yeah. I mean, I'm a big fan of like pagan horror, that type of stuff. And that's definitely up there with like Wicker Man.
And probably the first 10 minutes is the best 10 minutes of like any drama movie I've ever seen in my life. It's just, it gets you right there. Woof.
Well, I'm going to throw out two recommendations. Along the pagan horror line, there's a show on HBO right now called The Third Day, which is really, really cool. I don't want to spoil too much about it. It's about this mysterious island in the UK that is only accessible via a roadway that is covered by the ocean for most of the day. So you're kind of trapped there. And some spooky things happen. It's got Jude Law, Naomi Harris, definitely worth checking out. And I was at Beyond Fest this weekend and I saw the premiere of Wolf of Snow Hollow, the new Jim Cummings film.
I was there too. I thought that was rad. Yeah.
It was a lot of fun. I mean, Jim Cummings is going to be huge very soon, I think.
I talked to Jim in advance of Scare Me, by the way. I said, how did you do it? Because he did the triple threat thing. And he was one of the ones who said, you better learn your lines beyond anything. He really, really knows.
Look, it's in theaters.
Yep. In theaters now. I think it'll be on demand soon.
I was joking, but like, where am I going to go see
it? Drive-in. It's playing at the drive-in.
You're right.
People should definitely check that out, especially if they like Scare Me, because it's very similar. Writer, director, star pulls it off somehow. Well, Josh, thank you for your time. Good luck with the film. It's a ton of fun, and I think this is the perfect time for people to be watching it.
Thank you. Yeah, it's been wonderful to hear folks, especially who've watched it twice already. Like, that was my goal, is what's the movie you'd want to pop on in the background?
You know, I love it.
I'm thrilled. Yeah. Thank you for having me.
Thanks to my co-host Sade Sellers and to Josh Ruben for coming on the show. Scare Me is streaming right now on Shudder. And of course, thanks to you, our listeners. If you like this episode, leave us a review, and if you haven't already, subscribe on Apple Podcasts. For news about future episodes and more, like us on Facebook and follow us on Twitter at Final Draft Inc. and on Instagram at Final Draft Screenwriter. This episode was produced by Kayla Guess. Editing and post-production done by Sadie Dean. Music is by Santiago Arias. Thanks again, everyone. Until next time, right on.